BBC Audio presents The Spark, 11 Ideas to Change the World, presented by Helen Lewis.
What's the big idea? Welcome to The Spark, a weekly encounter with the writers and thinkers answering the world's most urgent questions. From politics to economics, from tech to the study of how we live, things are changing fast. This is your guide to the people and the ideas shaping our future. What happens when two economists have a baby? Data. When Emily Oster first got pregnant, she and her partner Jesse were bewildered by the huge volume of sometimes contradictory information out there. So she set out to discover the facts, everything from the true benefits of breastfeeding to whether it's okay to let children cry themselves to sleep. She wrote two books, both bestsellers, Expecting Better and Crib Sheet. And as she looked through the scientific papers and statistics, she learned something fundamental about human nature. Now she's set on changing the way we raise our children. Hello, Emily.
Hi, thanks for having me.
Thanks for being here. You got pregnant for the first time in 2010, and suddenly you received all this advice. What was it?
So there was all kinds of advice. I remember when my first prenatal visit, I came and they had me leave with a list of foods I could not eat. And that was one of the first things. It was like, here's this list. It was 2 pages long. It had all kinds of stuff on it. And I was like, wait, like, but why? Why can't I eat these? Can you tell me more? And they were like, no, your appointment's over. Here's your list. Goodbye. And I found that pregnancy had many things like that, where I was given advice or rules or restrictions and not told why, or not given the tools that I needed to understand why these restrictions were in place, which of them were important, which of them were less important. And so that frustration was really the initial source for writing these books.
So you said that you're not writing conventional parenting advice books. It's more like a kind of toolkit, right? So economics, we think of as a decision science. So this is a methodology for people to make their own personal decisions.
Yeah, I think of economics really as having two big pieces in the way that we're currently doing it. And one is really this decision-making piece, the idea that when you make choices, you should weigh the costs and benefits and think about structuring your choices in a way that is deliberate and thoughtful. And I think that's really one piece. And then there's a second piece, which is data, which is that when economists go to make decisions, go to make policies, we try very hard to understand what is really in the data and what can we learn from evidence. You know, are the relationships causal? Are they just correlations? And so some of the work of the book is about giving you decision tools, and some of the work of the book is about really digging in to the data, and then they come together, hopefully in a way that helps people make their own decisions in a way that is both right for them but also informed by the evidence.
Well, let's look at some of those specific examples then. So the first one, and one which I know I talked to someone about this program, and I love Emily Oster. She's the one who said I could have a glass of wine when I was pregnant. So the first one is about drinking alcohol when pregnant. You looked at the evidence for that and found what exactly?
So there's a sort of few kinds of evidence about this. I think the first thing to say is that there are very legitimate restrictions on drinking a lot during pregnancy. So binge drinking or heavy drinking is very dangerous and can cause significant birth defects. But when I was pregnant, what I wondered about was not, you know, can I drink a lot, but is it okay to have an occasional glass of wine? And there, the advice varies a lot, actually. So a lot of obstetricians in the U.S., mine included, said it was fine. Over time in the UK, sometimes the advice has been totally abstain, and sometimes the advice is closer to it's okay to have the occasional drink. So I wanted to dig into that data. And when I did, I found that there is a lot of evidence on occasional light drinking during pregnancy, and it is very reassuring. The evidence suggests that there are no measurable differences in kids' outcomes, things like IQ tests or behavior problems, between moms who didn't drink at all and moms who drank a little bit. So I really, in the book, I really dig into the details of that evidence and why, you know, some of the evidence is better than others and how we can learn from the best of it. But I would say the broad picture is that an occasional drink, you know, not more than one at a time, has not been shown to have damaging effects on babies.
And then we move on to breastfeeding. And this one was a particularly interesting one to me because it's a way of talking about one of the sort of stickiest things when you're talking about statistics that isn't obvious perhaps to lay people about the difference between correlation, things that happen at the same time, and causation, things which are directly linked to one another. One thing causes another. The evidence seems to suggest that breastfed babies do better, but that might be to do with factors other than the fact that they're breastfed.
Yeah, so the thing that makes breastfeeding so difficult to study is that the characteristics of who breastfeeds, it's not random. So moms who breastfeed, particularly in the U.S., but also sort of throughout the world, tend to be better educated. They tend to be richer. And those characteristics also correlate with good outcomes. So moms who are better educated tend to have kids who are better educated and who do better on other dimensions. But it's hard to know, you know, is it the breastfeeding that matters or is it these other characteristics of moms? And so, like, to take an example, I dig in the book into the question of whether breastfeeding raises IQ, which is something that people say a lot. And it is certainly the case that if you just went into the world and compared IQ test scores for kids who are breastfed to kids who are not, you would find that the kids who are breastfed are performing better on IQ tests. But if you dig into the data more deeply, it seems pretty clear that that is just a correlation, that is not a causal statement, that it's not that the breastfeeding causes the IQ, it's just that the moms who are breastfeeding are different than the moms who are not. And one simple way to see that is when we compare two kids in the same family. So when we take one mom with two different kids and one of them's breastfed and one of them's not, we don't see any differences in IQ across those kids. So although comparing across families, we see it, comparing within families, we don't. And that suggests that our across-family comparisons are probably driven by other differences between the moms and not by the breastfeeding itself. And so I do a lot of that kind of work around the case of breastfeeding, where it's really, really hard to separate out, you know, what's the breast milk and what's these other factors. But when you do that, it looks like at least some of the claims that are made about the benefits of breastfeeding are overstated. Maybe not all of them, but some of them.
And the final one that is, I think, a really striking example is controlled crying. You know, the idea that you should let babies cry themselves to sleep. And there are, you know, you summarise the research there. There are a bewildering number of different approaches. I think the controlled crying doesn't necessarily benefit from, is it being called extinction? You know, extinction training?
Yeah, not a great name. Not a great name.
It's not the best PR exercise at all.
No.
But, you know, there is an enormous pressure on the idea that it's a kind of cruel thing to do, that it stunts babies' attachments to let them cry out. But that's not at all supported by the research.
No, it's really not. So when you look at research on controlled crying on, you know, kids where parents use this kind of controlled crying approach, when you look at them, say, when they're 5 or 6, and you ask the question, well, are they less attached than kids who didn't use this? You don't see any evidence of that. Backing up, if you look at, you know, babies right after this, actually, if anything, you see that the babies who undergo the controlled crying the next day or in the sort of short period after, they tend to seem better rested and happier. So I'm not sure quite what we take from that. It may be that's that their parents are better rested, but it certainly there's no short-term or long-term impacts on babies. And the thing that I think is very important to say about this is that when we look at studies of this kind of approach, we see really good outcomes for parents. So when you look at the parental mental health, so parents tend to sleep better if their kids are sleeping better. Controlled crying helps babies sleep better. And we see big changes in maternal depression, in marital satisfaction, in other things that really matter for parents' relationships with their kids and for just their daily life. So this is a place where, you know, doesn't mean that everybody needs to do controlled crying. I think that's a pretty personal choice. But going around and telling people, if you do this, your kid will never love you, when parents are exhausted and depressed and sort of struggling with the mental health challenges of having a baby, I think that's really cruel.
We'll come back to the question of how to put the parent back into parenting later on. But for now, I just want to note how radical Emily Oster's intervention really is. These are not just hair-splitting debates about which brand of nappies to buy or which buggy is the best. Emily is using economics to illuminate a vast swathe of human life that can feel like unmapped territory, free from evidence-based scrutiny. We analyse data to help with many of the biggest questions in public life, from setting interest rates to whether cancer drugs are cost-effective. Yet when it comes to making decisions about how to raise the next generation, parents can feel like they are flailing around in the dark. supposedly authoritative books give.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.